Brighton.
Quite a few million pounds that we want to invest, and this is cash flow. So it's not budget, it's not funding, it's cash flow. And this may mean, because I'll give you an example, so if all our council tax and business rates comes in on the first of the month, which we all have been investing in millions of pounds, significant amount of money, but our payroll doesn't go out until the 18th of the month. During that time, the council has a massive amount of money within its bank account, so it doesn't get interest on its account at the moment. So what we would look to do is invest that money somewhere, and it could be just over those 2 weeks, it could be over a significant amount. It could be 3 years, it could be 5 years, it could be longer than 10 years. And this is all worked out in terms of our long-term cash flow. So we do invest that money at the moment, but we're quite risk averse in the way that we invest the money. So we tend to invest it in very secure, very traditional terms of investments. And what we're looking to do is actually just look at the different types of investments that are available, where we can invest that money to generate a higher rate of return. There's three particular areas that we have been looking. So one of them is ethical and green investments. And we are about to sign up with the public sector social impact fund, which is a brand new fund where it's only a council owned fund, so all councils will invest into that. And if a council has a particular idea, for example, it wants to build some social housing, or it wants to build a solar farm, then all council money will go into that, and it will pay for this, and it will generate a return on it. The second area is on commercial property. So we do have an opportunity to actually invest in commercial property that will just generate a return on income. And the third area is developer financing. So where developers actually need some financing to come and build something, we can offer developer financing as pension funds do at the moment. So what we're intending to do is to actually have a look and see if we can invest in some of these areas of higher interest. And before we would do this, we would do a piece of due diligence on every single thing that we would do here. So we have treasury advisors, so we would first get treasury advice, and then we would commission an external piece of due diligence. And this could take 6 months to do this due diligence. As a result of that, then we would have the assurance that we need whether the proposal is a robust proposal or not. Some of the ones that we know that we don't invest in already that other councils do are, they're there and available for us to invest in. So we would probably invest in those first of all, because we know that other councils have done this and they've got the assurance for it, and they can provide the assurance for it.
Okay, I think what I said was, if we would ask any questions from the whole of the same lives, we'd go through it each individual item. So it's up to us now.
Can I just, let's quick as you carry on with your presentation, if anybody's got a particular burning issue as the presentation's going, we just acknowledge and ask the question.
So income from new investments are a fantastic idea. I make it work. It starts the reason, isn't it? If you can get investments on money that's doing nothing, then do. You just mentioned ethical and green investments. Well, whilst that sounds like a fantastic headline that everyone can run off to the paper and say, oh, we're doing the right thing, loads of the investments that I've seen around ethical and green investments, the peer-to-peer lending, can you just assure us that we're not going to go to is run off and start putting money into peer-to-peer lending schemes, whereas normally FCA backed and not FSCS backed, and we're risking a lot of money that we might not get back with. And if you look at the press recently, there's a few that have gone bang and people have lost a lot of money. I'd like to see that for us.
Yeah, absolutely.
As
I said, we do extensive due diligence on this, and this new fund that we're actually entering into, so as I say, it's owned by local authorities. And the money that goes into it is will go into paying for something that our local authority has brought forward that they actually want to invest in, so things like social housing or something like that. But yeah, absolutely, we wouldn't invest in anything if the due diligence has come up and it gives us any small signs that something could go wrong, or it's not ethical, or it's not right for us, and we wouldn't do it.
So, new investments on commercial property that you mentioned.
if we were to invest in that, would the council become landlord?
It could do. That's one option. So the council could actually purchase property that has an anchor tenant, and the council could become landlord of that. What the council would do is probably employ a company to actually manage that investment, so the council wouldn't need to be involved in, you know, sort of facility management and all that kind of thing. That is an option. Another option is that we could actually enter into head lease ourselves on commercial property. There's lots of different ways that we would do. We don't know yet, none of these have actually come forward. What we need to do is a tender to commission a firm to actually do this for us on our behalf. But there's many options available. Again, it would have to be the right one for us. Okay, the next one is zero basing. This is something internal that we're doing really. So,
I'm not sure you've heard or understood the request, I think, the agreement, which is not to go through everything like that.
And all the last questions. So,
I did say if questions popped up as we were in the issue.
The suggestion is, I don't go through each house individually, but we've got the information in front of us. If members have queries, we ask them specifically. Then when questions end, we can go to the close of business.
Thank you. We will do that. Would you like to finish the presentation?
Apologies, Chef, that was my misunderstanding. So you don't want me to go through each one, you just want to add
one. No, I do. Unless we raise a question about it.
No, that's
stay there till the questions have ended. Don't disappear.
That's what I said before. If you carry on with your presentation, then anybody has a question.
Fine, yeah,
no
worries. So the next one is
right. Don't ask don't give a presentation. Chip all referee boards. Questions. Steve.
Yes, I've looked through the document and I know in other fields I work in that the 1% rise in the public sector lending rate, which was announced just on the telly, I can't see where that pressure is on the budget. Is that creating a pressure on the budget in terms of our borrowing overall?
So, not at the moment, it's on new borrowing. So for 2021, we have anticipated an amount of revenue impact for the capital programme. What we're trying to do, what we do is we do a mix of borrowing and a mix of using our internal reserves and cash flow as a result of that. So if there was something new that went into the capital programme that was large and specific, there would be a pressure. But at the moment, there's no pressure for us as it stands for next year.
Another question.
But just a comment, really. I mean, you know, I think we look at these, and sometimes these are set at budget time, and some deliver and some don't deliver. But I pose the question to myself and to the committee is, if we don't accept these financial treasury management type issues, what are the alternatives? And the alternatives are we're looking for more frontline controversial service delivery type options. So my view is that, you know, I always taking these with the best intent, and they have to be monitored closely as the budget year goes on. But if the officer is saying there's a degree of confidence behind, my view is that what is the alternative? That is a question. What is the alternative to taking these budgetary type measures?
Yes.
I was reading reports, and I noticed in Appendix 3 there's 0.3 million unachieved savings. Knowing that sometimes the people will say that we'll make savings here and there and they're not actually achieved, a couple of things is, what are those unachieved savings and what are officers doing to ensure if a department says we'll make these savings, they're actually achievable? So there's no use putting them there saying, put them into the budget, then finding out they are achievable.
I mean, that relates to the council's comment as well about how do we know that do know that some of them will be things that are beyond officers' control, for example. So what I do know is the assisted travel contract, so we had put some savings in for renegotiating and reducing the contract for assisted travel. And what we found in the year is demand has increased for that. So we can't actually achieve those savings because we're actually paying more for that. So that's something really that's sort of beyond our control in there as well. I don't know what they are, so they're top of my head. What I do know is there's no savings that have not been fully achieved. So that have not been fully achieved, if you see what I mean. So it's not a full saving that hasn't been achieved. It will be parts of lots of different savings that haven't been achieved for some reason. But I can certainly provide that information for you on that. And just to provide you with the assurance, I suppose, as well about this year, for 2020-2021. And every year, you know, I've kind of put more robust proposals in place to try and ensure that all the savings have gone through an internal due diligence process. We can provide the assurance that they will be achieved. And we've gone through an assessment of feasibility, acceptability, and deliverability, and also assess the risk and done a bit of sensitivity on whether they will or not be achieved. Unfortunately, we have got some that have not been achieved from last year. But for next year, that process has been a lot more robust, and it has gone through a lot more of a severe sort of process, really. And my finance team, actually, the officers will know, I've actually constantly gone back to the officers to ask them for the evidence and the assurance that those savings will be achieved from day one. So the process is a lot more robust now. I can just take Councillor Foulkes' first question really about what the alternatives. You're right, really. I mean, the savings that we have put forward don't really impact on any of the services that the council provide. And that's for good reason, is because the council, the cabinet have given us a clear steer that they don't want to significantly change or cut or close any services that are vital for vulnerable residents. So we've taken that steer and come up with these savings. If there was an alternative, we would have to look into that territory because there's nothing else that we can come up with.
Thanks, Chair. The Appendix 2, under children and families of the Environmental Court Health Authority, which I sit on, why is that under families and children? And where does that figure come from? I know that the levy is 105,000.
So apologies, I don't have information on that. Children and families are doing their own scrutiny on all these proposals. So the full proposals and details of that will be done under children and family scrutiny. All I know is it's inflationary contract increase, but I don't know what proportion or percentage that is of the total.
Simply because at the moment the safe and wiggle home is managed by the Director of Children's Services, so shares people would budgets to those. Again, it's part of what Sherry referred to earlier about the restructure. It isn't the children's, so they've taken that on within the children's department. It's an area that poor boys is currently managing. It's one of the popular services that look for it. It doesn't impact on the children's budget at all.
No, you're right, it's just the fact that the manager of that service is currently under the Director of Children's Services.
And again, it's looked after by the Liverpool City Council. And we contribute to it as do Sefton, and that's why it's right.
But
our levy
is 105,000.
Yeah. Any more questions or comments? Yes, Jo.
Thanks very much. Under the appendix on financial pressures, we've got rural growth, company 1.8 million to rephase the income from new generation developments. And I think rural growth could be just coming to this committee agreement. We've got a workshop coming up on those developments. Could you just explain what that is? Is it additional money we're spending out? When is that going to start coming back in from rural growth company? And also, what point was it breaking?
actually a savings item that we had in last year. So we had, anticipated some income coming in from Real Growth Company last year. It didn't come in, it won't come in 1920. So we put it in as a pressure, really. And that's as a result of the delay in going forward with Real Growth Company. So you know, I think so we had a legal challenge initially when we first appointed the contractor. That was that put us into a delay. And also now, because we're working with the within Rural Growth Company, we're working with Muse, we've got a much better relationship with Muse, having much more open and transparent conversations with them. And there has been changes to some of the proposals going forward for Rural Growth Company. So as a result of that, we are taking longer for a good reason, really, to make sure that when we get a partnership business plan to cabinet and sign, that it's right and it'll be right for the future. So we are anticipating some savings coming in 2021 for those instead.
Just showing the data of a bunch of business plan proposals who come out on the 24th of February. Well, that's the plan, but there will be the scrutiny workshops beforehand as well, and that will be set out exactly what will be the partnership business plan in the draft site development plans, and then we'll be working on those schemes. So they are on track with what we previously announced as well, despite the delays that the chair mentioned.
Possible appendix one that says review of council contracts, and that says reduction in costs and renegotiating all the seats of the council wide contract was $5 million. What does that cover?
So it covers a couple of things really. It's a couple of phases again. The first stage really is we've been reviewing all of the contracts that are up for renewal at the moment, and we've been looking to see whether those contracts can be or should be renewed in the same way as we've actually put them out previously, whether we need to renew them at all, whether the service is still there, and whether we still need that service, or actually whether we can commission that service in a different way or in a different format. So what we're looking at really is taking a bit more of a fit for purpose review to say, well, rather than just renewing a contract every time it comes up for renewal in the same way with the same company or in the same commission, we've been actually looking and saying, you know, could we deliver this service in a different way? Could we deliver it in a better way? Could actually we support maybe the third sector or charity sector in tendering for these contracts rather than going and providing local rather than just going with the same suppliers? So as a result of that, we found £1 million of those savings already. The next phase really is to have the conversations with suppliers and contractors who have existing contracts in place. To actually say to them, we're reviewing all of the contracts that we have at the moment across the council and repeating that same exercise and saying, you know, council's under financial difficulty. Is there any way that we could actually come and talk to you about the way the service is provided and how much we pay for this service? And is there a negotiation that we could enter into with the contractors and the suppliers to say, we can't afford to pay this much money for this much service anymore? Can we go to be doing something differently, or are you prepared to reduce the value of the contract? What some councils have done is actually written out to all suppliers with inflationary increases to say, we can't afford to pay inflationary increases this year on your contract because of the council's financial position. Will you accept that we don't pay that for 1 year? And what we've known is that in some areas it has been really successful. Suppliers have actually worked with the council to say, yeah, that's fine, you know, we won't take an inflationary increase this year. Some suppliers will come back and say, absolutely not, you know, you're contractually legally obliged to pay this, and in that case they have been paying more. But it's just going into that negotiation with our suppliers to say, what can we do? And the figure has actually come from some sort of benchmarking that we've done from other councils as well, as to what potentially we could get savings as a result of that. Say what we know is straight away, just from reviewing the ones that are up for renewal now, we've got £1 million straight away.
Two recommendations in front of us today.
present time, of course, we dealt with one of the major ones earlier on, which was the review of new ferry. The second one is in relation to the mobile home park in New Brighton. We've done most of the work on that, we've just got a final piece to do and hope to get that done ready so that we will present the report at the final select committee before we change the new system.
Is the report called carrying happy?
No, it isn't. It's camp events, yes. It's camp events. Yeah, it could have been, but it is camp events. There's no more other items on the list. Has anybody got any thoughts of anything that needs to be done? There is the Scrutiny workshop, the regeneration projects. It was already in the diary, unfortunately, it coincides with the day of Councillor Wallasey's funeral. I'm sorry about that, but the programme is set, and I hope as many people as possible can attend that evening and carry on with the good work that's being done by the select committee. That's it. Thank you all for a good evening.
Thank you.